of QKD. There are two, let's say, folkloric personages, Alice and Bob. They want to exchange a secret message, and there is a spy, an eavesdropper, which is called Eve, and which tries to intercept the message. So in principle, QKD allows secret message exchange with information theoretical security. That is, it is warranted against an all-powerful eavesdropper limited only by the laws of physics. So the trick is that there is a quantum channel, and in this quantum channel, there are photonic carriers, photons or weak pulses, I will describe more, which are sent from Alice to Bob. And there is also a classical authenticated channel. So Eve can spy both the quantum channel and the classical authenticated channel, but Alice must be sure that she's speaking with Bob and the reverse. And this is what means authenticated. Alice, there must be some initial trick which allows Alice to be sure that she's speaking to Bob and not to Eve. Apart from that, Eve can do whatever is possible according to physics in order to intercept this message. So the trick is that due to quantum mechanics, anything Eve is doing to spy the quantum channel will create some noise, some back action, some perturbation. And so by analyzing errors created in the channel, Alice and Bob can bound the amount of information available to Eve, and then with processing, I will explain, this yield the secret key. So in principle, it's secure against any kind of software attack. Even a quantum computer cannot, it's even secure against a quantum computer. And in principle, it's a fully reliable solution to the key distribution problem. So there are typically two big families of QKD. The most famous is with discrete variable, with photons. So the idea is to use to the optical carrier is encoded on a photon, single photons in principle. It can use photon polarization, photon phase, photon time arrival. One has to make quantum superpositions. And basically, the trick is that one uses single photon detection, photon counters. So after that, the key is available. The clicks translate into secret bits. There is still a lot of processing needed, but it's rather simple. And there are proofs for security, for general attacks, any kind of quantum allowed computer. For even if the size of the sample is finite, and there are okay, all kind of stuff. For continuous variable, the trick is that we will not use single photons. We will use quadrature, as I explained in details yesterday, is X and P's, non-computing optical quadratures. And so the detector is not a photon counter. It is a coherent detector, homodyne, heterodyne. These are variants. Basically, there is a local oscillator, as I explained yesterday. Then what you get is continuous data, so you want bit at the end, so the error correction is a little bit more tricky, and we'll explain that. And then there are the proofs, the status of the proofs is quite similar as for discrete variables. So for discrete variables, the most famous protocols are BB84, the historical Bennett-Brassard introduced in 1984. There are many variants, decoy state, coherent one-way, etc. For continuous variable, there are various kinds of modulation, and I will explain that in details later. So the main advantage of continuous variable with respect to discrete is that it completely runs with standard telecom components. There is no photon counters, no cooling, only coherent detection. And it is actually extremely close to what is doing now in coherent optical telecom. I will also explain that. Okay, so how does it work? So this is the same idea, Alice, Bob, Eve, but Alice will not send photons, she will just send weak light pulses. So as I said yesterday, with some amplitude and phase. And so these pulses are modulated, you want to send some data. So it's a random modulation. Alice picks up a point in the complex plane. This has some noise, this little quantum noise, little blue circle. But there is a random distribution, a Gaussian random distribution of these things which are sent to the channel. And then Bob is using an homodyne detection with a local oscillator. And by choosing the phase, the relative phase of the signal and local oscillator, it can choose to measure either X or P, again, as I explained yesterday. So this is working. So there have been many, many demonstration. So this I scored this one, which was quite nice. It was in 2008 in Vienna. It was a big European project called SecoQC, quantum cryptography. So you see global network for secure communication based on quantum cryptography. So the final demonstration was in Vienna, in Austria. So there were many, many fiber links. You see seven nodes, a lot of links between all these nodes, and all these things were working together. And what was nice, it was basically all the possible implementation of QKD. So this is sort of a list. So there was a demonstration by the group of Nicolas Gisin, which is called CAO, it's a Swiss demonstration. So, you know, Swiss CAOs. It's coherent one way, actually. There was a demonstration also by Toshiba from Cambridge. It's Toshiba Cambridge in UK. This was our demonstration, which was that we did with a French company, Thales, and this was a CVQKD, which was working quite well in a box, etc. So this has been working for a few months. And so the different links were attributed to different protocols, and all these protocols were able to share keys, to manage keys. It was quite nice. And there was even an entangled protocol, which was made in Vienna by the group of Anton Zalika. This was reproduced. This was a long time ago, but it was also reproduced in Tokyo several times. But this one was a nice demonstration. After that, there were many others. So this was one in the US a few years ago by a company named Battelle in Ohio. There is a current demonstrator, which is done in UK around Bristol. It's a part of their quantum communication hub. And again, there are many protocols, many links, but it's all in UK. Even more recently in China, they have set up a huge network, 2,000 kilometers long network between Beijing and Shanghai. So you can only go, I will explain, about 50 kilometers at a time. So there are many, many nodes which are supposed to be secure. It's a so-called trusted node model. And by making many little hops, you can go 2,000 kilometers from Beijing to Shanghai with intermediate stations, local distribution, etc. It's a very sophisticated thing. So if you make a little summary of the standard of current standard of fiber optics QKD, you see there are many demonstrations. So the two things are how far you can go, which depends on the channel loss. The further you go, the higher the loss, and the secret key rates that you get. So you see, you can go to very, so this is a distance equivalent to this loss. You can go to very large distance, but then you need a super detector, it's photon counting, it's cryogenic photon counting, liquid helium, etc., which is not simple. So if you have more standard photon counters, where you are more in this area, and actually commercial devices are working in this area, which is typically 10-20 dB loss, about 10 dB loss, corresponding to about 50 to 100 kilometers with that kind of rate. So all these things are all kind of demonstration. You find CAO, again, decoy sets, which is now very standard in photon counting QKD, and our CV. So this is our demonstration, which is 80 kilometers. And I will explain in more details how it works and what we want to do. Okay, little stuff for questions. You can write, as yesterday, you can write the question in the chat. Maybe Duke.
I don't see question for Tammy.
No questions for the time being.
May I ask one point?
Sure.
So you have on this plot some functions, your functions, some others, and there's a sort of fidelity, channel loss versus security key rate. Is there a theoretical prediction limit, best way function, or
there is an absolute limit of relating loss to security, which is sort of called entanglement breaking limit. That is, you when you have less and less signal and more loss, at some point you end up in the noise of your system because you have just less and less signal, and so this limit is very general. So if you want to overcome this limit, you have to, I will tell that, I'll told it already yesterday, you have to use quantum repeaters, or obviously you have to use other ways than fiber optics. For instance, if you use the distribution with a satellite, then you can go much further, because this drop is related to the loss, to how. So if you can overcome this loss by one trick or another, then you can go to further distance. But for this kind of loss distance thing, you have this general relation. You see all points more or less lined up on this line.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's the fact that if you want to get a key, you need photons at the end. And if the photons don't arrive, finally it stops. So here you go further, because the dark rate, actually, for photon counting, the limitation is the dark rate. And if you use superconducting detector, you have extremely low dark rate. And so you have extremely low bit rate. You see, it's 0.1 bit per second, so it's very slow. So if you have any kind of dark rate beyond that, you are dead. So you need basically zero dark rate for your photon counter, but for cryogenic detectors can do that.
Thank you.
There is maybe another question. Are you using QRNG as well for measurement-based selection? Yes, if you are supposed to do that, if you want to be safe, so that you can make compromise. But for instance, in this SECO QC demonstration, all boxes were using idequantic QRNG, actually, these things that you can buy and put in a computer. Samsung and SK Telecom launched a phone with some kind of, yes, I will speak about that later. There are various of these quantum phones. Phone with some sort of QKD implemented Galaxy A quantum. Okay, I don't exactly know what this one is doing, but I will speak again later on with about quantum, so-called quantum phone, which is a Chinese one, actually. Okay, so let's go on. Okay. So, okay, so now I would like to explain a little bit more how CVQKD is working. So as I said, Alice is sending to Bob small laser pulses, which are chosen in a Gaussian modulation. So you have to imagine this is a random distribution of chosen pulses, and you have a Gaussian in P and a Gaussian in X. So it's a double Gaussian in the complex plane. So she picks up one of these things, send it to Bob. Bob chooses to measure X or P, get some data, and then out of that, they want to construct a secret key. So how does it work? So you see, with clicks, with a photon, single photon, a click is more or less a bit. Here, it's continuous data, so you don't see the bits immediately. And also, you have to evaluate how much information is sent by Alice to Bob by using this Gaussian modulation. So this is given by a very famous formula, but it's basically all Shannon thing. So Shannon formula, this one, gives the mutual information sent by exchange between Alice and Bob for this kind of Gaussian modulation. And the formula, it's 1/2 of log 2 of 1 plus the ratio of the variance of the signal divided by the variance of the noise. And this formula also for Gaussian modulation achieves the channel capacity. So it's actually the maximum amount of information you can send with an energy bound. So the variance of the signal gives a sort of energy limit. And then this is the maximum amount of information you can send. So I don't know whether everybody knows mutual information. I have some slides to remind you what it is. So if there is a urgent need, I will show these slides. So it's related to Shannon's entropy, X for the, so X is the message sent by Alice, Y is the message received by Bob. Then you can calculate this entropy, mutual entropy, conditional entropy, and then finally you evaluate this quantity, which is a number of bit per symbol exchange in the canal. And it's a very general formula. So how does it work? So Alice has to choose some random point in the complex plane, X, A, P, A. And then she will send a coherent set, which is a small laser pulse, which has this amplitude and this phase that is correspond to XA and PA, and she sends that to the signal, to the channel. Then Bob will receive a version of the pulse, which will be generally attenuated, so smaller and more noisy. And then he can measure either XB or PB. He has to choose again due to the homodyne detection. Then he tells Alice, after detecting, he tells Alice what it measured, for instance, this one, X. And then Alice and Bob agree on the basis choice, X, and keep the relevant value. So you see that by doing that many, many times with random values of X and P's, Alice and Bob will get correlated data, and this correlated data will carry an amount of information which is just given by this Shannon's formula. So clearly, by just doing that, they exchange information, but and this is classical, and the basic challenge for QKD is to make this information secure. This information, again, maybe I emphasize that, will not be a message. It will be just correlated data, correlated noise, actually. And out of this correlated noise, they will be able to extract a key. And then the key will be used to encode data. So just always remember in QKD, what you exchange is not a message. I call it a signal, but it's not really a signal. It's random data. And then the goal of the maneuver is to have the same secret bits exchanged between Alice and Bob. And they should have the same bits at the end. And these bits should be completely unknown by Eve. This is the rule of the game. Okay, so now more details. So now you have Alice, Bob, okay, you recognize them, and Eve, who has a mustache now, okay. And so you have this mutual information everywhere. You have the mutual information IAB, I just quoted, but you have also IAE and IBE. So what are the conditions to get a key? So this was this is another idea by Cesar and Corner, basically, which tells that the size of the key will be basically the difference between IAB and IAE, which is sort of normal. That is information advantage of Alice and Bob over the information over what Eve knows is what gives them a secret key at the end. So the more precisely, they can distill from their correlated key elements a common secret key of size S, which is the largest of the two differences, IAB minus IAE or IAB minus IBE, bits per key element, so bits per symbol. Key element is the number of pulses that they send. So the crucial remark is that it's enough that IAB is larger than the smallest of IAE or IBE. So you see, it's the sup of the difference. So actually, they can choose the best. So if, for instance, if this one is smaller, IAB is fixed it's the same in both cases. If this one is smaller, they should choose this value, obviously, because the sup is larger. And if this one is smaller, they should choose this value. So they have a choice of either trying to evaluate what Eve knows about Alice data or what Eve knows about Bob's data. And this will be absolutely crucial in the end. So for instance, if this one is the smallest, then in order to correct data, to get from correlated data to bits, Alice has to send some information, which is called basically syndrome, error, to correct errors. And so if IAE is the smallest, the trick of Alice and Bob is to keep this quantity constant. And then Alice will send public data for error correction. And this will be available both to Eve and to Bob. So this is called direct reconciliation protocol because the error correction goes the same way as the optical signal, which was sent from Alice to Bob. Now, if IBE is the smallest, the reconciliation, the error correction should go the other way. And so Bob will give correction data to Alice and also to Eve, and Alice will correct his data. And this is called the reverse reconciliation protocol. So you see, in this case, the basis of the key is what was sent by Alice. In this case, the basis of the key is what was received by Bob. And actually, it's very general that Eve always knows more about Eve than about Bob. So actually, this way, the so-called reverse reconciliation protocol is better, and I will show that in details later. So obviously, also Alice and Bob. So you see, it's a difference between IAB and IAE and this one. But Alice and Bob don't know these quantities because they don't know what Eve is doing. So the only thing they can do, since they don't know the quantity, is to bound them. And the trick is that by looking, again, this is a basic trick of quantum cryptography, by looking at errors created by Eve, Alice and Bob will be able to put a bound on this one and to put a bound on this one. And then they will use the best bound, use this theorem, and get the secret key. So this is the idea. So let's go into more detail. So one has to evaluate all this mutual information. So let's start with this one. So IAB is, so it's in this paper. This one is the standard one, it's IAB. And similarly, for IAE, there is a similar formula. So you see, this is the variance of the signal. This is the variance of the noise. And the noise has a component N0, which is shot noise, because it's a coherent state. And another component, which is a noise added by the channel. And so we will call that equivalent channel noise. And there is an equivalent channel noise for Bob and an equivalent channel noise for Eve. And now all the trick is that due to the no cloning theorem, it is done in this paper, you can demonstrate that there is a lower bound for the product of these two equivalent noise. The product of these two is bounded by N0. N0 is a shot noise level in any units you like, but it's a square of the shot noise level. So it tells that if Bob gets a low noise, then Eve will have a high one, and if reverse. So this is a no cloning bound. So you see, this, if you have this no cloning bound, which is purely quantum, then you win, because since Alice and Bob can measure this noise from their data, then they get a bound on this one. And then there is a maximum value for this IAE, which is just obtained by putting this bound in this formula, and it is obviously this thing. So you see the trick in that in this formula, you have only quantities which are known by Alice and Bob, VA and zero, and this one. And the key size is the difference between this one that they know and this one that they bound. So this is the trick. So this is for direct reconciliation because it's IAE here. Now, if you go to reverse reconciliation, it's a little bit more tricky because as I said, the basis of the key is Bob's results. So Alice and Eve, and both Alice and Eve, have to infer Bob's measurement results. So it's depend on what is called the conditional variance. So for instance, knowing is that her data, Eve has to infer Bob's data. And this is given by this quantity. It goes all the possible way, Alice about X Bob, Eve about P Bob, etc. And then you can show, it's done in this Nature paper, that there are also bounds on these conditional variance, which are also sort of Heisenberg limits. So you see the product of conditional variance relative to Alice and Eve are bounded. And then one can use again Shannon theorem, one can make some algebra, and one gets again a bound, which is not the same as previously, but which involves the same quantity, the equivalent noise B, the shot noise, the VA, etc. And again, the key size is the difference between IAB and IB, and the best possible IB. So you see in the trick, in both cases, the trick is that Alice and Bob can measure the no VA, can measure the shot noise, can measure the noise in the channel. And from that, they can bound both AEB and ABE, and then they can get size of the key according to this Cesar-Corner theorem. So now how it looks like in practice. So the equivalent noise of the channel has two components. So the there is noise due to losses. If you lose your signal, the loss in quantum optics will be replaced by shot noise. So you have simply noise due to the channel. If the transmission of the channel is one, this noise is zero. But if the transmission of the channel goes down, there is more and more apparent noise, which is just due to the fact that you lose your signal. This is just channel loss replaced by vacuum noise. And then there is another component, which is called excess noise, which is noise beyond that. For instance, if there is fluorescence, if put from fluorescence, stray photon in the line, This will put an even higher noise that we call excess noise. So how does it look? For instance, this is a channel transmission. So this is zero transmission, one transmission. This is IAB, the information between Alice and Bob. And the VA is calculated to get 2 bits per symbol. So now if T is equal to one, Alice and Bob get 2 bits per symbol. But now if the transmission decreases, A and B decreases like that. And then you end up with a small value, zero value for zero transmission, obviously. For the AEB, it's just the opposite because you are a little bit paranoid and everything which is not received by Bob goes to Eve. So at the end, you see Alice and Bob get nothing and Eve gets everything. She has the two. And the secret key is the difference between the red and the green. So you see, this is what is obtained by direct reconciliation. So you immediately see a trouble when the transmission is less than 50%. It means that Eve gets more information than Alice, and there is no more key because the red, this should be positive. So the red should be above the green. So at 50% transmission, this T line here, there is no more key. And also the excess noise should not be too large. So you see there is an intrinsic limitation to direct reconciliation that it cannot transmit keys beyond 3 dB loss, beyond the transmission line 50%. Now the big trick is that it's no more true for inverse because inverse is red minus blue. And you see that now it goes to arbitrarily large distance. So it's very surprising because you see in this regime, for instance, Eve gets more light than Bob. Most of the light goes to Eve, sorry. So why is it, what can it, is it possible that there is still a key? The trick is that the key is based on what Bob received. And Alice always know more about what Bob received than Eve. This is a red curve, is always above the blue curve. And this means that you can go to arbitrarily distance, despite the fact that most of the light went to Eve. So this is the first time, this was found by one of my students, Frédéric Grossens. The first time he told me that, I could not believe it. But okay, this is, there have been many, many proofs, you know, it's now almost 20 years old. So this is perfectly fine. Now, if you have excess noise, it's a little bit worse, obviously, because Eve can exploit this excess noise, so the difference is smaller, but still it works. Pretty well, as long as so there are limits to this excess noise. For direct, this excess noise should not be larger than shot noise limit, and for reverse, it should be smaller than half of shot noise. So you see here, direct is a little bit better, but actually the advantage of transmission is huge, and everybody is using reverse reconciliation. Okay, it's not yet the end of the story, because now you have correlated data. Out of this data, you must extract bits. So how do you extract bits from continuous data? You basically make slices. So for instance, if it is a probability distribution of what is received by Bob, just the sign of the data makes 0 or 1. Then you split again, and you get more 0 and 1. And for instance, if you are here, you have or here, you have 4 bits, which is 1, 1, 0, 1. So you see, by making slices which are smaller and smaller, you get more and more data. Obviously, you cannot go too far because at the end there is no more, it's only noise at the end if you split too much. And how much bit you can extract from your continuous data is exactly what is given by on the average by Shannon's formulas, one half of log two, etc. So in order to extract these bits, you need error correction. There are many very sophisticated ways. So we use for basically LDPC, it's loud density parity check. It's big matrices. It's very efficient. It's classical. And it gives basically almost the number of bits that you expect from Shannon's formula. So you see a little drawing. So here, these are the exchange mutual information. This is what is known by Eve. In order to correct the errors, you have to send syndrome. So you there is some addition here. But if it is done properly, the difference, delta I, which is the size of the key, should remain the same. So you correct data. Now Alice and Bob have exactly the same data. no error because they are corrected, but this data is partly known by Eve. So in order to eliminate Eve's knowledge, you use hash functions, or which is called privacy amplification. So there is the same thing with discrete variables. So the result of privacy is that the information of Eve is completely erased. And what remains at the end is the initial difference, the delta I, and this is your secret key. After all these efforts, you get it. So you see, you get the correlated data, you make all this numerization, and then you correct error, you make the hash function, and you get the secret key at the end. All these parts, especially this one, is just the same as in DVQKT. A little bit more trouble. you see here there is a beta, which means that when you do that, you lose a little bit of your mutual information, which is not good because instead of the difference IAB minus IB, now it's beta IAB, and beta is very close to one as possible. But still, there is a little trouble because if you start from IAB, you go to beta IAB, and then if you make the subtraction to here, you see that these two curves cross here. And so there is a limit in distance. For lower transmission, it doesn't work anymore unless you have beta equal one. But by working hard with very good correcting code, you can get beta like 0.98, but 0.98 is not one. And so you have a little limitation here. So if you go to, so this is as a function of the channel transmission from 0 to 1. Now, very often one prefers to use distance from so distance is the loss in fibers is 0.2 dB per kilometer. So you translate the transmission into a distance. And then without, with beta equal one, you can go arbitrarily far. When beta is not one, for instance, this value, it stops at this point. But it can, I will show later, you can go to pretty large distance, up to 100 kilometers typically. But still, imperfect correction efficiency induces a limit to the secure distance. Okay, finished, not yet, because all these calculations were based on Shannon's information for IAB and for IB. Now, imagine that Eve as a quantum computer. She is able to make sort of global quantum processing about on all his data. And this is called collective attacks. So now the question is, so that let's say this is individual attacks. Eve is able to store the data, but not to make global attacks on the data. If she can make global quantum attack on the data, then you have to use this Olivo quantity, which is sort of a quantum replacement of Shannon's information. So, but the idea is exactly the same. The difference now, instead of being IAB minus IB, it's IAB minus KIB. You can calculate KIB because, okay, there are some theorems which allows you to calculate KIB. You see KIB is not so much different from IB. So there is a little additional reduction in key rate, but a significant increase in secrecy because the full theorem must use KIB and Olivo and not IB and Shannon. Shannon is what is called restricted attack. For general attack, you have to use this Olivo quantity. Okay, that's the end. So let's summarize. If you send coherence set in a line, they are modified by loss and excess noise. You always suppose in quantum cryptography that all loss go to Eve and all excess noise is due to Eve. It may be not true, but you do that by let's say, to be on the safe side. Then Alice and Bob can make evaluate the channel, and then they get bounds. So I remind this formula. So if you have perfect reconciliation efficiency, this is this formula, which is positive. So the key rate is positive for any channel transmission. In practice, you get this beta. So if it is positive, if t is not too small, and this is shown by this thing. So this is the ideal value, and this is a practical value. You can also do that in distance. So Okay, so this is the basically the idea of the security proofs for CVQKD. You see, it's not trivial. There was many other theorems, very powerful theorems. The last one were done by my previous postdocs, Anthony Le Verrier. It was published in Physics Web Letters 2017. And now these proofs are extremely safe. So they are basically, you see, the data processing is more tricky than for DVQKD. But the proofs have an equivalent quality, and so at the end you can invite include all kind of defects like finite regime. I did not speak about that, but it's another subtlety which applies also to both CV and DV. So everything is taken into account, and we can claim that we have good proofs for CVQKD. Okay, questions. This was the hard part. The other parts will be easier.
I have a question again.
Yes.
An earlier slide, you showed us a Heisenberg-like relation between noises, right? And EQB times and EQE was greater than or equal to N0 squared,
mm-hmm.
a relation like this. This lower bound, is it related to optimal approximate cloning or?
Yes, it's all related. Basically, you can make initially we got this idea from that. Initially in the 90s, I worked on QAD measurements. So QND measurement, quantum non-demolition, tells you how much you can preserve your signal and how much information you can extract by preserving your signal. So one of them is how well you can preserve and what kind of perturbation, minimal perturbation you can do. So in quantum QND measurement, as you know, there is no limit. You can make a perfect QND measurement of a variable. So in principle, you would say, but then if you can make a perfect QND measurement, Eve can get all the information. But this is true only if you know the quadrature. And all the trick is that Eve does not know the quadrature in advance. So she cannot do a good, for instance, if she makes an ideal quantum measurement of X, it will be a total mess for P. And this is the physical idea. And since she does not know in advance whether she should measure X or P because the modulation is randomly encoded, she do whatever she does is actually making what is called a Gaussian attack, which is a round attack for X and P, and then you end up in all these limits that I have shown. Mm-hmm. So these limits are the QND limit in the situation where you don't know what to measure. And Eve does not know. This is all the trick, obviously, in all, it's the same thing for BB84, you know, with this polarization like that or like that. You don't know which basis to use, and this creates the errors, basically. If you know in advance what you measure, in which basis to measure in quantum mechanics, you can measure perfectly. Mm-hmm. You are stuck if you don't know what to measure, and then the limits are sort of average QND limits in the situation where you don't know which variable to measure. This is the physical idea, and you see the physical idea is basically the same for DV and CV, except that the quantity for BB84 it's a polarization, and for CV it's a quadrature. But it's the ignorance of the good basis which protects the secrecy.
Thank you.
Is it the answer to your question?
No, thank you very much.
Are there other questions? Or everybody is sleeping, or I was too fast? Don't hesitate.
You're explaining well, probably, but maybe we will have some more questions towards the end. By the way, to remind you, we have something like 15 minutes or a little bit more. It is up to you, your time.
Okay. Okay, so how much time do I still have?
15 minutes plus, something plus.
Okay.
Something so like 20, let's say, okay.
Okay, so I'm maybe a little bit too slow, but okay, so this was a difficult part anyway.
Okay. Thank you.
The other ones can be faster. So let's go on. Okay, so it works. So then you can implement that. So it's basically you get laser diodes. You split the diodes. This will be the local oscillator. You make random phase and amplitude modulation with telecom devices. And this was in our setup a few years ago. You put a delay and then you send in the channel the local oscillator and the signal. Then at the receiver, you recover the clock, recover the polarization, split again the signal and the local oscillator, and you beat them on the modi detection with a random choice of the basis. So you see, these are all telecom. These photodiodes are PIN, standard telecom photodiodes. No photon counting, no cooling, nothing. This is a telecom device. So this is how it looks. So you have, okay, fibers, modulators, etc. This is again the second QC demonstration. So there were all these nodes, and this was our link, CV link, where we were able during several months to distribute the key. So this is only 8 hours with about 10 kilobits per second. So this was done a long time ago. More recently, what we did, you get a key, but what do you do with the key? So with a key, you need to encrypt data, as I said. So the QKD box only gives you a key. Then you have to manage this key and to give this key to a device which is called an encryptor, which will use, for instance, AES, which is a standard encrypting thing. And then you can exchange real messages at a very high bitrate. So what the QKD does is that it allows you to renew the AES key. You don't know exactly how often it should be renewed, but the basic idea is same also for DV. You increase the refreshing rate of the key down to 10 seconds instead of maybe months or years. And so if you exchange too much data, this open attack channel, and if you renew the key more often, then you increase the security, which is the idea of this kind of demonstration. So this is the encryptor, which is called Mistral. It's fabricated by Thales in France. And then you have the whole thing with the computer, the encryptor, the QKD box. It works. It was installed in France. So this is south of Paris. And it worked also for several months from July to October. So this was the key rate, you see. So there, it's a little bit fluctuating, but there are explanations here. This was an air conditioning failure in the hub. And here the PC was dead. The QKD was not dead, but the PC was dead. So we repaired the PC and it went again. So there were improved versions also, which were done by a company, SecureNet, and they were able to sell it. So they sold a few of them, one is still working in Tokyo, I think. And so this is typically what they got from this box. So you see it was 10 kilobits per second at 20 kilometers, and it was able to work up to 80 kilometers with some subtleties on finite side. I did not tell that, but I can explain if you want. And so this is sort of the what was done, the best was done so far with commercial CVQKD. So now there are new devices, even Huawei is making, you know, CVQKD in Munich, but this one is still a reference. Okay, there was hacking also. So you know the famous Vadim Makarov, who is hacking everything. So for CVQKD, hacking is difficult. First, there is no real commercial device. So Vadim likes to hack commercial devices. He was able to hack ID Quantique devices. So hackers will have, but this is very difficult to, because most of the hacking is based on attacks on photon counters. You can blind them, you can saturate them. For CVQKD, is more tricky. I don't say it's impossible, but we did, in collaboration with Erlangen, some tried to hack CVQKD, and actually it did not work. It was okay. But there are new ideas. You know, hackers have a lot of imagination, so the story is not finished. But I say that hacking on CV is not so easy. So there are many, many CVs also, many papers by groups in Australia, in China, a lot in China also now, in Germany also, in Erlangen. Okay, so questions. Maybe I skip these questions because these things were, there will be questions again later. I just continue on this sort of commercial QKD. So from what I said so far, QKD looks very nice. Okay, so you should all have QKD. For instance, ID Quantique in the company in Geneva is selling these boxes, and you can put them everywhere. And actually, they sell them pretty well. There are many other companies in Japan, Korea, SK Telecom, for instance, we just heard about it in a question, which is correlated, we have basically bought Idequantic, strongly invested in Idequantic now, in Australia, in the USA, in France, and well, okay, there was Smart Quantum closed, Secunet is closed also, but Thales is also interested in that, and there are new companies, and also, as I said, we are working with Nokia, with a big telecom manufacturer. Okay, and then came China. So you have this 2,000 kilometers network, so there you need these boxes. So you need companies to make the boxes. So there are a collection of companies. So a lot of small companies making the boxes, but also super big giants like Huawei, who is investing in QKD. Now they have a quantum lab in Munich, in Germany. Alibaba, who is doing buying everything, and ZTE. So ZTE is a smartphone, and then you get this quantum smartphone from ZTE. So what is quantum? It's not super clear what is quantum in the phone. My understanding of that is that since you have this long channel in China, you can hook up on the link anywhere at each of the nodes. And my guess is that the smartphone is able to download secret keys which were distributed throughout this link. So it's not really quantum. It's not like if you go to the bank to get money, here you go to a hub to get a secret key. But this is only my guess because, you know, making a quote, it's not impossible. There are people working on a cheap and simple quantum cryptography. It's not impossible in principle to exchange photons between a smartphone and a receiver, like a money place. My guess is more that it's basically sharing a key which has been distributed in the quantum way, but it's very active. There are a lot of ideas. So, okay. So from that again, you should have this phone in your pocket instead of your Huawei. You should buy a ZTE and you get quantum security. So actually, it's not maybe as nice as that. And so there are what is called market inhibitors. These are slides which are taken from Andrew Schiltz, who is actually trying to build and sell QKD, and he's in Toshiba in Cambridge. He's an excellent, well-known expert of the field. So what are the market inhibitors? First, it's expensive. If you want to buy an Idequantic box, it's 150,000 euros. Okay, you hesitate. So you should improve on that. It should be cheaper if you want it to be widely bought. Also, typically you have this point-to-point dark optical fiber. It's a little bit tricky, so it lacks network integration. You would like QKD to be more transparent, less visible to the user. Also, you would like crypto integration and applications, more application, not only key distribution. And also, if you buy a super expensive box, you would like a standard and certified. You would like to be sure that it's quantum and not fake quantum. And all this has to be, so these are serious problems. And actually now all projects, QKD projects are working to solve this thing. So a little bit, I will speak briefly about these two. So high cost. So this is a box. This one was sent 70,000 euros, but now Telecom is going into silicon chips. And so it can be made very small and nothing prevents you to think about a little thing that you can plug in your PC and which distributes a secret key. So we worked on that. I will go fast because, so you can make this silicon chips. They are very small, so you see the chip is hidden here. All the things are connectors. It's complicated to fabricate because it's you know, it has to go to foundry. It's silicon. It's like microelectronics. So you have many runs. It takes a lot of time, a lot of thing, and you can ask questions if you want. Then you get something like that where the chip is absolutely invisible here, and then you are wiring SMA cables, etc. This is Alice, this is Bob, modulators, chips, etc. It works, you get a short noise limited detection on a chip. You can exchange key, And finally, you get this curve as usual. So these are, you can evaluate the excess noise, the quantum efficiency of everything, and you get secret bits in principle. So this is the big difference between the previous curve, is that this is not a commercial device. It is just on a lab, and this thing is not yet fully integrated. So it's very small, but it's not fully integrated. So it's still an ongoing work. So, and it's the same for DV. So CV, DV are all working on these chips to make the thing a small, reliable, cheap, etc. Okay, since time is going, I will just go on and ask for questions at the end. So network integration. So network integration is basically, in my mind, using telecom coherent superfast telecom system to do QKD. So this is a coherent superfast telecom system. You have a laser, amplitude modulation, a signal, power adjust. It goes to a fiber, then it goes to Bob. Use heterodyne detection. You don't send the local oscillator. You see in previous slide, I was sending the local oscillator. Now it's completely obsolete. You have a local oscillator in the detector. You beat them, so this is the detection. And then you recover the phase by electronic processing, digital signal processing, super fast. And then you can, in principle, recover the phase and transmit data with very high efficiency and very high speed, and exactly how a coherent telecom system is working. Now add Bob TXIVA and you get a QKD system. It's a little bit exaggerated, but you see the hardware is exactly the same. You have to operate it in a slightly different way to ensure security of the lab, etc. But you can use separate lasers. For instance, we are using pure photonics, which are good lasers, the narrow bandwidths, commercial coherent detectors, and we have to mostly to work on this DSP to get the secret key. So this is a typical dual quadrature, dual polarization detector. It's called, this one is done by Finisar. It's a commercial device, you see Finisar. And so these things are super fast detectors, which work at the quantum noise level. So we made measurement. You see it's quantum noise limited up to almost 15 gigahertz. Previously, my rip rate was one megahertz. Now you see this one is 15 gigahertz, is 1,000 times faster at least. So even if you stay in this area, you see this is 5 gigahertz. So just in this area, you have a very excellent short noise limited detection over very high bandwidths. Also, you should send a Gaussian modulation. Actually, in telecom, they don't use really Gaussians. They use what they call the shaped constellations. So it's a set of points in the complex plane, which are well identified and which are able to transmit data very close to Shannon's limit. And so we are working with this guy who is in Nokia, who is a super expert for that, for classical telecom. But again, the idea can be transferred to quantum. So the proofs again, so there is a more theory. So the proofs, best proofs are for Gaussian modulation. If you make a constellation, so the simplest constellation is just 4 points. So it's called QPSK, quantum phase shift keying, quadrature phase shift keying. Then you need the new proofs, but we did that. So we did that for some friends who are computer scientists. This was published in this paper just last year. And so now we have proofs for modulation schemes, which are more discrete than Gaussian. Gaussian would be a full modulation, you see, all points. The fact that you predetermine the points makes everything easier. The modulation is easier, the error correction is easier. So this is very standard, QPSK. This is not ideal for QKD. You would like more points. So presently we are working somewhere between this 4 point thing and these many, many point things. But the key rate, so there are proofs, I think all this is ongoing work. Okay, so there are projects. There are two big European projects running, CIVIC, specifically on continuous variable QKD, and this open QKD, which is all kind of QKD. And the idea is to develop use case, etc., to make them useful, also practical cases. So it's a very big project with many, many groups. You see 38 partners for almost all European countries, with companies, Toshiba, British Telecom, IDEQUANTIC. XBlue. We are working with them, Thales also. Okay, so I'm going fast, but okay, so these are sort of general information on QKD. So you see continuous variables are part of the game, and they are developing also. Now, all this is about point-to-point links. You can make networks, but the nodes of the network should be themselves secure, classically protected. This is a so-called trusted network model. If you want to go very fast, you would need these quantum repeaters. I spoke about quantum repeaters last time. Well, it's not yet working at this degree of reliability. So there were many. The basic answer is to use trusted networks. So as CQC, I described, there are many of them in Tokyo, in Cambridge, in China, and in the EU, they also apply a large testbed. If you want to go really far, another solution is satellite. So I told briefly about that last time. So there is a Chinese satellite, and there are also many efforts, European efforts, to make things with small satellites, with CubeSats, with etc. So this is developing very fast also. The idea of CVQKD, of QKD in space, come actually from Europe, from Vienna, more than 20 years ago also, but it was first implemented by China. CVQKD in space, so well, why not? It's not complete because you need, but there is also coherent detection from satellite. There is a German company, TISAT, who is specialized in that. So it's not impossible. There are papers also, not yet experiment, but theory papers telling that it's possible to have a secret key rate with CVQKD for low Earth orbit satellites. Okay, so Europe is working a lot on that with these new plans, as I said before. And I think more or less I will stop that. So this is part of the team. Eleni is here, so as I told, and so most of these people were involved in the chip business. Okay, so I think I can stop here and now ask for questions. Thank you.
We thank you. Thank you for presentation and also perfect timing. We have already two questions from Mustafa Gündoğan in questions and answers part.
What is the origin of those kings in key rate versus the yes? It's for the the idea is that when you use this so-called LDPC code, low density parity check, you have to optimize the code as a function of the error rate. So when you increase the distance, you increase the error rate, and so you have to change the code. So you lose a little bit because at the end of one code, and when the code becomes bad, you change the code, you optimize the parameters, the so-called key rate, that is how many bits you get out from the data. And so each kink is a change in the code to take a code which is more adapted to the local situation, to the current transmission. I think this answers the question. I have another question. I recall some researchers were not happy with ID quantic lead-based QKD system. They were arguing that it's not quantum since it emits weak classical pulses. Yes, sure. So this has been a big debate. It's not also LED, it's a weak laser. So can we get security with weak laser pulses? So this has been much debated. So in principle, if you could get a single photon source, it would be much better. Now everybody use weak lasers. And so there is a trick which has been invented to solve this problem, which is called decoy states. And decoy states is now the answer to this question. Instead of sending pulses which have a given level, you send pulses with random levels. And so this prevents some attacks by Eve, and this makes the thing secure even if with weak light. So this is generally admitted. There are proofs also. So you see, it looks a little bit like our scheme, but it's still in the photon counting regime. It's not a modern detection. You basically make random random size of the pulse that you send. So you can choose, for instance, 0.1 photon per pulse, 0.3 photon per pulse, and 0.8 photon per pulse. And you switch between the three randomly, and then it makes that Eve cannot apply what is called photon number splitting attack. So this is generally admitted. So sorry, I meant QNG. So what does that mean? So QRNG are quantum random number generators. So they are used in QKD devices. Presently, most people are using IDEQuantic. Lead-based random number generators are disputed. Yes, but it's a little bit technical. Now, you know, there are other ones. There are many companies now selling QRNG. There is one. The one we plan to use is the one which is made in Barcelona. Because the coordinator of our civic project is in Barcelona. So it's not based on photon counting, it's based on digitizing quantum noise from basically AAC, super fluorescence diodes. There are issues, you know, but there are all kinds of tests, basically standardized tests for randomness. And all these quantum devices, as far as I know, pass this test. So they are good in that sense. Now there are discussions. It also leads what is the real super ultimate security. Then you should get it not from beam splitting, but from entanglement. And for instance, people who did loophole free Bell test, like in the USA, in NIST. They are now using, they use also their loophole free Bell test to make a so-called perfect random number generator. But it's very, very heavy experiment. It's not really practical. You know, the idea is that if you make a Bell test, you have these correlated photons. These photons should be really, really random. Otherwise, you would get faster than light influences. So there are all kinds of proofs based on Bell's inequalities, connecting Bell's inequality tests to randomness. And this is considered as the ultimate randomness. But in practice, it's very tricky. And one uses either photon on beam splitter or digitizing quantum noise. It's considered to be reasonably safe. Other questions?
Any other? In the meantime, may I ask you something about just the experiment that you mentioned, these loop or free Bell tests. Are there new experiments or other groups showing this
loophole-free Bell test?
Loophole-free, yes, test.
So there were initially four, then there was a fourth one. The fourth one is a group of Harald. So you know the fourth. So there was an experiment in Delft with Envy Center by Aaron Alanson, Vienna by Marisa Justina and Anton Zeilinger with photons, another one in Boulder in NIST also with photons, and another one with atoms, which was done in Munich in the group of Harald Weinfurter, which is a little bit like Envy Centers, but it's basically spin correlation. Again, it's not photons. You entangle, you have remote atoms, and then you make Bell measurement on the atoms to check the correlation, and it does violate Bell's inequalities, loophole free. These are the four that I know. I think the Vienna one is more or less stopped. The NIST one is going on, and they are doing other things with that, like random number generation, teleportation, super efficiency, high efficiency teleportation. And Hanson also is going on. He wants to do higher rate. He wants to turn into his Bell equality into a quantum network. And Weinfurter is also going on. Also, I don't know exactly what are his plans now. And there are new experiments, but maybe I missed some. I don't know.
Thank you very much, Jacob. Let's see. If I think we have no more questions. So thank you very much, Professor Grangier, for a very nice presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you. So now we can continue. Thanks.
Okay.
So we can pass to our next speaker, and I will leave my chair to Kadir Durak. By the way, Professor Link, everything okay? You are ready?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, okay. Kadir, where are you?
I'm here.
Yeah. Okay, then I am leaving my position to you, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Professor Granger, for the talk, and thank you all for attending this conference on quantum optics. I will introduce the next speaker, Professor Alexander Link. Let me briefly introduce him. Alexander Link achieved his PhD from Center for Quantum Technologies. Sorry, maybe I just opened up the video. Okay. In National University of Singapore in 2008. And after that, he did research as a postdoctoral researcher at NIST for 2 years. Then he returned back to Center for Quantum Technologies in National University of Singapore as an assistant professor in 2010. And I can say that his climbing the academic career steps so fast and also so successful was an inspiration for most of the PhD students in CQT, including myself. He was even selected as one of the 40 influential people under 40 years old in Asia. And he has been doing research with entangled photons around 20 years, as far as I know. And he's mostly recognized for his contributions on space-based quantum experiments. He sent the first entangled photon source into space and successfully performed the first quantum experiment in space in the history. He currently put the pace one level up by trying a quantum satellite constellation, which could be the key component for the ultimate goal of a quantum global quantum internet. Well, I think we are living in really exciting times, which is the dawn of the second quantum revolution. Thanks to people like Alexander Link and all the other speakers. Okay, the talk will be asynchronous as, to avoid some online problems. But he's here with us, Professor Alexander Link. So at the end of the talk, you can, he will answer our questions. So you can use your question and answer button to post your questions. Okay, so please feel free to ask him questions that you have about future shaping quantum technologies. The talk is titled as Engineering a Quantum Satellite Constellation. By saying that, I leave the word to Professor Alexander Link. Okay, okay.
And I'm a principal investigator at the Center for Quantum Technologies, located at the National University of Singapore. Today, in the next 40 minutes, I would like to share with you the research work that my team has been working on for the past decade, which concerns the distribution of entanglement from a satellite. Now, we know that this work is possible because our Chinese colleagues have demonstrated that they have the Misha satellite that you see here in this picture, which can be used to carry out quantum communication from space. What I would like to talk about today is not so much about the Misha satellite, but how we can actually build a constellation of these quantum satellites using the kind of technology that Misha was demonstrating. I'll talk about some of the concerns and how you can actually arrange the satellites, what are the trade-offs, and also talk about how you can actually use more cost-effective platforms in order to build the satellite. So there's some physics in here, but there's also a build of engineering as well. The motivation for all of this work is the quantum internet, where we know that if we can build a network for distributing entanglement around the world, we can do things like quantum key distribution, teleportation, or connecting quantum sensors and quantum computers. The building block for entanglement distribution will be based on photon pairs, or in particular, photon pairs that have very strong correlations that we call entanglement. The way we make photon pairs is based on a process called spontaneous parametric downconversion, or SPDC. In this picture over here, you're looking at a SPDC source. Typically, there's a pump, which is the blue light, it interacts with nonlinear material, and sometimes the blue photons will downconvert into a pair of lower energy photons that have momentum and energy conservation. In this picture, you can see the path taken by these entangled photons that go to the left and to the right. And what you can do is you can couple these photons into an optical fiber or a telescope for onward transmission. Now, we know how to build and engineer these devices and also make them quite rugged. We know how to also make them quite compact.